Do you know what it's like to lose someone you love? Now, imagine someone you love being brutally murdered. Your son. Your daughter.
The neighbors that went in found my son, Neil, who was 27, lying at the top of the stairs, so covered in blood that they couldn't tell what his ethnicity was.
It took 5 hours for her to die. She bled to death on the operating table.
He was met her with a shotgun and blew her head off.
Meet the other victims of violence, the families of the murder victims. What sets these people and tens of thousands like them apart is they were twice victimized by murder and by the criminal justice system. The criminal justice system that failed to recognize that these people had any right to be involved in the process. The system that ignored them, forgot them, and often intentionally excluded them, stripping them of their rights and dignity. When Lee Bertha Pickett Allen's 17-year-old son was killed, she got the message loud and clear. She was not very important.
They had held a preliminary hearing, but they didn't tell us because they didn't think that we were interested enough, that we were grieving, and we would not be interested in coming to a preliminary hearing.
But that wasn't the end of the horror. Imagine running into your daughter's killer out in public. It happened to Marsy's mother.
They arrested him, and he was in jail. So we had the funeral, and a week later, we went to the cemetery to put flowers on the grave, and we were coming back, and my husband Bob said, I'm gonna stop in front of the market, just run out and get a loaf of bread. So just as I got out to get a loaf of bread, the murderer was coming out of the market.
They had no idea the killer was out on bail, but back then, that was simply standard operating procedure. Slowly, victims and their families started reaching out to one another and started asking questions. Why don't we have a constitutional right to be notified about hearings? Why don't we have the right to speak up and be heard in the criminal justice system? Why is it that defendants seem to have all the rights?
I've seen firsthand the terrible ordeal that victims' families are forced to go through. How there's no notification if an accused killer gets out on bail. And if there is a conviction, there are those endless parole hearings to attend. My mother suffered a heart attack from the stress of one of those hearings. I knew that something had to be done.
Despite strong opposition from special interests and a well-financed negative media campaign, California voters passed Marsy's Law on November 4th, 2008, and it went into effect the next day. Marsy's Law provides crime victims with many new rights, including these highlights. Marsy's Law grants victims the right to justice and due process. It also gives victims the right to be informed and to participate at critical stages. Marsy's Law also provides victims' families with the right to be heard. So when they attend, say, a bail hearing, they now have a voice in court and may persuade a judge to deny bail. For example, when the victim's safety is threatened. Marsy's Law doesn't just help victims of crime. It's also a tool for the men and women in the state's law enforcement agencies who have dedicated their lives to fighting crime. Marsy's Law is the strongest victim's bill of rights in any state in the nation. Its passage means that, for the first time, victims in California have meaningful and enforceable rights. Marsy's Law gives victims a meaningful opportunity to participate in parole proceedings, and in that way, they set their safety and the safety of the general public as the critical standard before any release decisions are made. And now, victims' families are no longer invisible, no longer forgotten, the way LaWanda Hawkins once was.
The Marsy Law changed that. It made you give the voice, it made your child come to life, it gave victims rights. It's not like bringing our kids back to life, but it made our children not die in vain.